It's Sunday morning, and we are in a study. We started off on prophecy. And prophecy is about everything the Bible is about. Prophecy is not just the end of time. Prophecy is about what Israel became involved in while they were a nation under kings. You say, Jim, why do you keep putting that on the board? The Bible. The Bible is about Israel. And Israel was a nation. They were actually under judges. And the judges were people like Joshua, Othniel, Shamgar, Deborah. These were the people that were the judges. Gideon, Samson. Samson was a judge. He wasn't just a guy that went around killing Philistines with the jawbone of an ass. He was a judge in Israel. And these, and Israel was ruled by judges before they were ruled by kings. In fact, the judge was merely a prophet that God would come to or have an angel come to him and talk to him and give him instructions. Well, during the time of the kings, there were many prophets. A prophet got his instruction directly from God. From God. And the prophet would go and give it out to the priest and the king. And the priest and the king were the instructors of Israel. The priest was the religious instructor, and the king was the secular, or the man that was supposed to be enforcing the laws of the prophet. And they had all of these kings in Israel, starting with God was the first king. And the reason Israel is called Kingdom of God is God was their king. And I'm going to go through some of that. And then the people come up and said in the 8th chapter of 1 Samuel, give us a king that he may rule over us. Let me stop for a minute. People say, why do you say all these things? Why do you teach for an hour and a half? I can't even get started in 30 minutes. You're here to learn as well as to fellowship. The reason I put all this information on the board is I want you to learn the Bible. That's what we're here for. If you go to a seminary, you can believe me, I've known a lot of seminary professors in my life. I've heard classes of them. Most of them are boring. They don't put the information on the board that I put on. What you're getting here at Grace and Truth Ministries is a special seminary for yourself. You will learn a lot of Bible if you'll pay attention and if you'll come as much as you can and write notes, write these notes down that I'm putting on the board. I'm putting history. I'm putting Greek and Hebrew words on the board. I'm putting culture, customs, idioms, metaphors, the way they thought and the way they believed, not only 2,000 years ago during the days of Jesus, but back 4,000 years ago when Moses was leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. I've had people say, where can I go to seminary? You can come here and you'll learn more. We do 3 lessons a week. If you go to a seminary, you'll get 5 days a week, but you won't get more than 3 lessons in a given subject. I'm putting all kind of subjects on the board. You will learn more here. You say, Jim, is this a boast? No, I know. I know a lot of Bible teachers. I knew a lot of them coming up. Most of them are really boring to me. They may give you 2 Greek words in a Greek class or 3 in a week, and I'm going to put 50 on the board in one lesson. So if you want to learn, this is like going to a seminary, except I put out more information. I speak foolishly. I speak like the world speaks, but I put out more information in one lesson than you'll get in a church in 10 years. Now, let's get back to this. I want you to learn this. If you don't know what the Bible's talking about, I'm going to try to reveal some things to you that I've been finding out this past week or so. You cannot just come up and say, I learned everything there is to learn about this over here. If you don't know that baptized does not mean to dip in water, it does not mean to sprinkle with water. It was a word in the first century that was used by women, it meant to stain and to dye. Comes from baptizo, baptizo, and bapto. If you don't know, if you have a McClellan and Strong encyclopedia, look up baptize. They'll tell you it was, they had no word in the English language to translate these two words. Baptizo means to cover. Bapto means to stain with a dye. If you don't know that a blood baptism in the first century meant a martyrdom or to be martyred or to die, what are you going to do with the Luke the 12th chapter when Jesus says, I have a baptism to be baptized with. How am I held together until it be accomplished? How are you going to know what that means? How are you going to know what it means when Jesus tells James and John in the 10th chapter of Matthew, can you be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? This is 3 years or 3.5 years after he was washed in water. What was the washing in water? That was a proselyte baptism. How are you going to know what that is if you don't read a book like Edersheim? Or you don't research it in McClellan and Stronger and Hastings Encyclopedia? I've been accused of using too much extra biblical material. That's what I'm going to use to teach you what these words meant in the first century. I want you to know what they mean. How are you going to know what this means when he tells James and John, speaking of his death on the cross the next day, can you be baptized with this baptism I'm baptized with? If you don't know, a blood baptism was a death in the first century. You can't just read that out of the Bible and understand it. You got to go back to their day and time, read Greek culture, read Jewish culture. How are you going to know what the word belly means? Belly. Belly was an Epicurean term. It meant all the desires of a man, all of his spiritual desires were seated in his belly. And they recognized what we mean when we say we get sick at our stomach because we see a little children on the TV in Africa starving to death and that bothers us so bad. Or you see an animal over at the side of the road and it makes you feel bad for it. Or you see some animal abused. You see the advertisement come on by these animal rights people and it comes on the TV and the dogs are looking pitiful and you get that bad feeling in your stomach. They said that was the belly. And the Bible says men there in Philippians, how are you going to know what Paul meant in Philippians when he said, men hate the cross of Christ because their God is their belly and they mind earthly things. How are you going to know what mind means unless you look up mind in your concordance, phroneo, it means their sentiments. On earthly things, and earthly is the word gay, and it means dirt or soil. And everything you see is made of dirt, and that's what men want. New cars, new houses, new this, new that, diamond rings, some vacation. It's all dirt. That's what men think about, dirt. And that's self, isn't it? Self. How are you going to know that? How are you going to know? How are you going to know that Revelation is a Jewish book? Revelation is a Jewish book if you don't study Jewish culture over here. You got seven candlesticks in the first chapter. I wonder where that come from. Maybe the book of Exodus? In Exodus, the 28th chapter? How are you going to know the 24 elders around the throne? 24 elders around the throne in Revelation, the 4th chapter. And how are you going to know what the throne of God is unless you study the Old Testament? And the throne of God was the Ark of the Covenant, where he came and sat down and ruled Israel from. How are you going to know that unless you know the throne was the Ark? And how are you going to know the 24 elders unless you study 1 Chronicles, the 24th chapter, where you got 24 sons of Aaron through his two sons, Eleazar and Ithamar. And that's the 24 elders. They got 24 sons together, and their sons will be the high priesthood of Israel. How are you going to know that? How are you going to know what the 24 elders are? And they are ministering around the throne or around the Ark of the Covenant. And how are you going to understand that if you don't look at a copy of the temple and the Ark of the Covenant was inside the law was written on tables of stone kept inside the Ark of the Covenant. Now the law is written on fleshy tables of our hearts. And the veil is the Bible says the veil is the flesh is the bread is the body, and the body is the church. And this was called the house of God. How are you going to know that if you don't study Jewishness? You're not going to know that, are you? And the seven candlesticks there, you find them in the first chapter of Revelation. And that was the official light in Israel. And the altar was where they offered the daily sacrifice, and we give our bodies a living sacrifice. How are you going to know that if you don't study Jewishness? You're not going to know it. I'm giving you information. You're not going to get in a church anywhere in America. I know you're not. Where do you get that, Jim Brown? You make it up? I've got a library in my home I've been building for over 50 years. And I go into all kinds of books and men of authority and men who know in encyclopedias, like the McClellan and Strong and the Hastings and the Judaican. How are you going to know this? You're not going to know it. You can't just read the Bible and not use extra biblical material. And you got to examine that material and find out if these guys know what they're talking about. I studied for the first 20 years of my study life, 25. Studied a lot of things wrong. I had to eject all this bad stuff. I had to throw out pre-trib rapture. I had to throw out accept Christ, sinner's prayer for salvation. I had to throw out millennium. I believed all that when I started, but I don't believe it anymore. Because I had heard my father and all of his preacher friends say those things, and I thought you could accept Christ when the Bible says you can't. How are you going to find that out? You're not. And I can keep going through all of this, and y'all have heard me preach on this. Revelation is a Jewish book, and you can find your answers in the Old Testament. Now, and how are you going to know that if you don't know what a shadow is? When the Bible says all these rituals over here in Old Testament were a shadow, they were a shade. I want to say some more about shades, skia. If you go outside, this was the shadow over here. The New Testament is the very image. That's why we're spiritual Israel. You find that in Ephesians, the second chapter, Colossians, the second chapter. You will find us being spiritual Israel. We're the temple. We're the house of God. That's what it was. That's what the tabernacle was called over here, or the temple over here. You're not going to know that if somebody don't tell you, unless you're willing to study. If you can't study, and some of you middle age, you can't study because you're busy with your jobs. If you come here, I'll lay it out in front of you. And it's better than going to a seminary. I know I've known seminary professors. Most of them didn't know a whole lot. They went 8 years to school to get their doctorate, and that's the last time they studied. I don't study to get a doctor's degree. I studied when I was 17, started studying because I wanted to learn what the Bible meant. Now, let me give you something about shadows. Let me show you something. And this has to do with demons as well. Demons. We've been talking about demons. There's no such thing as demons. Back in the ancient world, they believed the people that were superstitious believed that shadows were gods or demons. When we think of demon, we think of something evil. When they said demon, they meant a god. Hercules was a god standing over the parapet of heaven, looking down upon the world, going, I need to go down there and inhabit this man and lead him to good fortune. Demons were benevolent gods in the first century. The word demon or daemonion was not used. Where do you get this? In all of my materials? I've got all kinds of materials written by sociologists who do nothing but study history and culture that goes back into the ancient world. I can't even begin. I got enough notes up here to preach for a year on my desk up here. And why do you put so many notes out? I'm afraid I'll run out of stuff to say. And I can't get through one page of it. I have a real fear of preaching the Word of God. I'm afraid not to be overly prepared. Now, let me show you something over in Acts, the fifth chapter. You're not going to know this. unless somebody goes to extra biblical material to show you what it meant. Look here in the 5th chapter of Acts. I may just feed you a bunch of information today. I have things that puzzle me, and I have seen the puzzles come together over the years. If you find something over here in Genesis, you find it over here in Joshua, and you find it over here in the books of the Kings, and you find it over here in Colossians, and you find it over in Revelation, all of it's going to be related. God is not a haphazard God saying something over here that doesn't connect somehow with this over here. Everything is an orderly arrangement, isn't it? For God so loved the world. Whether anybody likes it or not, the word world is cosmos. It means an orderly arrangement. And it is masculine and gender. There is an orderly arrangement of mankind. When it's orderly, it's mathematically structured together. When I first heard predestination, you've heard me say this before. Had a young guy walk up to me, I was about 21 years old. I had suspected predestination. I had suspected the sovereignty of God. But he walked up and quoted Romans 8:29, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son." When he quoted to me, my life changed. I went, "Whoa, whoa." If that's true, God's mathematical. He's not haphazard. He doesn't just throw things out there. When you look at the word tasso, the Greek word, it means an orderly arrangement. That's the word Paul used in Acts 13:48. "As many as were ordained to eternal life believe." Orderly arranged. Orderly arranged. Masculine. In fact, if you take the word cosmos, cosmios, we get the word cosmetic. Doesn't a woman orderly arrange your face? You know what she says? "I got to go put on my face." You know what she says? When you look up the word cosmetic in here, it will tell you it comes from the word cosmos, meaning an orderly arrangement. This is Webster's Dictionary. It'll tell you what word it comes from in the Greek. Everybody needs a good Webster's Dictionary. Webster's New World Dictionary, Collegiate Dictionary. It'll give you the word. If you look up the word agony, it'll tell you it comes from the word agonize or agon. The agon was the arena where they wrestled and they fought, and the lions would eat the Christians and they'd turn them over to the gladiators. That was the agon. Agonize. Strive to enter at the straight gate. Agonizomai. You're not going to. And how are you going to know that's an imperative command unless you look it up? An imperative was a command. Strive. That's not an invitation. That is a command to he that hath an ears to hear, let him hear. Every time you find "let him hear," here is the word akouo, and it is an imperative mood. It's a command to everyone that has ears. Now, look here in the 5th chapter of Acts. And this is Peter preaching. God just got through killing Ananias and Sapphira for lying to the Holy Ghost. And in verse 12, "By the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch," that was on the front of the temple. "And the rest durst no man join himself to them, but the people magnified them, and the believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes both of men and women." Now look at verse 15. Now remember I said, they said shadows were demons or gods. Watch who's talking and who's doing the thinking here. Always pay attention who's talking, who's doing the thinking, who's doing the answering. "Insomuch that they brought forth the sick unto the couches and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter," now this is not what Peter's believing, and it's not what Peter's saying. It's what the superstitious people are believing, that the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them so they would be healed. They thought shadows were gods. This is not saying Peter was saying his shadow was a god. The people were believing that. Was that true? No. This is the word skia. They thought when he passed by, his shade over them would heal them. Notice who's doing this, doing the thinking here. The people are, not Peter. You got to pay real close attention to what's being said. Now, let me go ahead and read some of this and watch what we see on the next verse. There came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folk and them that were vexed with unclean spirits. Now you have to understand, in the first century, they believed that unclean spirits were demons, daemonion. Remember, daemonion means to distribute fortunes. That's where we get our word demon. But they said they were gods. Gods. What's going on in the minds of the people when they're talking to Jesus? It's not what the Bible's talking about. It's what they're thinking. To be vexed with an unclean spirit. You got several words for vexed. This word vexed in Acts 5:16 is the word akleo, O-C-H. This is connected. They are thinking they're vexed with unclean spirits. The word akleo means to come in multitudes or rabble or to riot. It means to riot. I got much to say about riot. I don't know if I'll go to that right now because I want to get to some of these other things. The common word riot is the word asozo or asotia. Asotia. Now this will show that to be vexed or to riot, riot comes from the word sozo. Sozo. Sozo is the word saved, placing the alpha privative, the first letter of the Greek alphabet, in front of a word as a negative particle. It negates the word. It gives an opposite meaning. To negate means to make it negative to the word. So it means to act unsaved. That's actually what the Bible's talking about when it's talking about rioting. I'm going to come back to the word riot. Now, we don't believe in demons here. People say demons come and possess a man. Well, that's in the ancient world, that was called animism. Animism is where they would say that if a man's spirit left him, that it could wander around the world. And they called these ghosts, or they said your spirit could leave your body and wander around the world. And if it was in dry places, it had no food, no water. I've got a set of books. It's called Mythology of All Races. It's a big set. I think it's about 16 volumes, and plus an index volume. It'll take you anywhere in the world and tell you about these, what they believed about unclean spirits. I want us to go back over to, gosh, what I need to, let's go somewhere what I can show you what God says. They said these unclean spirits, which were the spirits of dead people or ancestors, they said that they could wander around the world and come and possess a body or possess a tree or possess a rock, or going to the mountains. They had so many superstitions. Look at what Jesus says in Matthew, the 15th chapter. Look at Matthew 15. I'll just give you a verse here, and you'll find Matthew 15, the same thing is said over in the book of Mark. Matthew 15. Look at verse 16. Jesus said, are you also without understanding? He's talking to the Pharisees. That whatsoever entereth in at the mouth goeth into the belly, and is cast out into the draught. They're saying, he's saying, you're going to expel whatever you eat with your mouth. But those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart. They are what defile a man. For out of the heart proceeds evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. Now, what can be worse than that? How could a demon be worse than that? That's all self. These are the things which defile a man, but to eat with unwashed hands defiles not a man. He's talking about the rituals of the Pharisees. He's saying what defiles a man is what comes out of his heart. Look over here at Mark's account of this same situation, Mark the 7th chapter. And he says over here in Mark, where they're condemning Jesus, he's saying it's not what, verse 14, and when he called all the people unto him, he said, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand. There's nothing from outside of a man without a man. From outside of a man that entering into him can defile him. Jesus is saying here, demons cannot come into you and defile you. It what comes out of your heart. But the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man. If any man have ears to hear, now hear this. And that's an imperative mood, that word here. Let him hear. Let him understand. Now, gosh, I got so many places I want to go. Let's go back to the 17th chapter of Matthew. We were saying these things. I don't know where to go. Let me do something before I run out of time. Let me go back over. I'll come back to the 7. Let me write this on the board. Matthew 17. I'll know to come back here. I've got enough lessons up here, 17. I'll just put that up here. Let's go over to, and all of these things have to blend. They have to synthesize together. You know what synthesize means, don't you? It means to mesh mathematically equally together. Every verse has to come together. You cannot go over here and prove a verse wrong over here. You cannot have tongues over here in the New Testament, and you cannot have tongues and not go back to Genesis 11, where God says, all the earth was one language and one speech. And he said, when they said, let us make up our own doctrine, let us make us a name. He said, now, since they've made up their own doctrine, name is the word Shem, and it means our own doctrine, our own instruction. We don't like Shem telling us what to do. That's the second-born son of Noah. So we're going to, and the word name is the word Shem all through the Old Testament. We'll make up our own instruction, and that's what men do. And he said, now I will confuse their languages. You cannot teach Acts 2 without going back here. You can't teach 1 Corinthians 14 about tongues without going back to here and without going back to the history of Israel, where they went after other gods. They went after Baal in the grove. God scattered them all over the earth. When they were all over the earth for at least 100 years or 75 to 100 years, they quit speaking the Hebrew and they were speaking the tongues, the dialects and the glossa. Everything in the Bible, when I teach, I see the Bible as one big picture in a mosaic. I spent 60 years studying it, and I see this huge picture. Whenever I say these things, nothing is separated from anything else. Do y'all understand that? I hope you can get a hold of that. I'm going to show you something this morning over here in Matthew the 12th chapter, then I'm going to go back over to Luke the 11th chapter. I've been hitting on something and I'm wrestling with it, and it's been amazing some of the things I've seen on it. It's about bones. I've struggled with something on bones for years. I'm not talking about Johnny Bones Jones either. It's about bones. very significant. I've had something going through my head. This is one of those things I've never talked to you about. I've told you I have things going on in my head, and I don't ever mention it to you because I haven't come to any conclusions. But I've been hitting something lately, and one thing will connect, this will connect with this, and this will connect with this. And all of a sudden, I'll hit something over here. I said, gosh, I didn't know that. But I've known it was in the Bible, all through the Bible. Now, look over here in Matthew 12:28. But if I cast out devils, daemonion is the word, by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you. Or else how can one enter into a strong man's house? He is equating daemonion with the strong man, isn't he? The house of God is here, is us. The pagans said that the body housed the ghost or the spirit. That's what the pagans said. And that if the spirit got loose, it could go over here and possess a man. That was an ancestor or a god. That's what a demon was. They called their gods by the title of demons or daemonion. That's not something I made up. You can get that in all kinds of books. My history books, my books on demons and devils in the Bible. And these are sociologists that'll take you back through history and say, this is where it started. Or this will be men in history will study history or chronology. And they'll take you back to where it all began. You can't just come up and read the Bible and say, I think this means. All the preachers ever around, that's the way they talked. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods? The strong man is you. Boy, it's amazing. The word bones, the Hebrew word esam, means strength. And they say, or it meant many or numbers. Numbers. And they said, without the bones, the spirit would fly around all over the world, wherever it wanted to land, especially in a family member, and possess them. And usually it was a family. This would connect with the man in Luke 8, where he was among the tombs talking to his ancestors or his familiar spirits. Gosh, that would take us back to ventriloquism and the myth in the stomach, wouldn't it? Remember that? The word familiar spirit is the word ob. It means bottle. And a bottle was a goat's stomach that the people who wanted to fool somebody and had a strap on it, and they would say they would talk to their ancestors by peeping and muttering in squeaky voices, and they were getting money from the people, and that was called necromancy. And when they translated the word familiar spirit from the Old Testament Hebrew into the Septuagint, LXX, in 200 B.C., then translated it in gastromuthos. You realize how many myths they had in the ancient world? It meant a gastro means stomach, in means within, myth, muthos means a myth in the stomach. The translators of the Septuagint said this was a myth in the stomach of the goat, that it wasn't real. When they were practicing necromancy, they weren't talking to the dead. They were pretending to talk to the dead in the stomach of the goat so that they could get money from people. The love of money is the root of all evil. There was no ancestors in the goat's belly. And the men who translated the Septuagint into the Greek, they translated the Old Testament Hebrew into the Greek, they said that's a myth. And Paul talks of fables. When he talks of fables, the word is muthos. It is the word myth. He said, don't believe these old wives' fables and tales that you hear. But they did. So the strong man, he'll spoil his house. That's when the kingdom of God, which is ancient Israel's title, because God was their king, when they were under kings, they said, give us a king to rule over us. As soon as they got a king, Saul, everything got all messed up. Now, look over here in Luke. This will take us to the bones, okay? I was reading in one of my, in the Hastings Encyclopedia when this hit me. All right. And I'll be honest with you, I haven't figured it all out yet, but I've been thinking about it for 35 or 40 years or more about the bones. Now, 12th chapter of Luke, it has to do with these wandering spirits. Remember, Paul said to the Jew, became I as a Jew, I became as a Greek to the Greeks. He didn't say I became a Greek. He didn't say I became a Jew. I became as a Jew. He said, I become all things to all men that I might by all means save some. So I'm going to talk to them in their vernacular, in their language, in what they understand to be in their mystery religions. I'm going to use their terminology. Paul used born again. Jesus used born again. They had that in the mystery religions. They had a blood baptism in the mystery religions. They had a Eucharist in the mystery religions. They would talk about being born again on their tombstones. Born again for eternity. You could go into one of their... Whenever Jesus is using these words, he's using the words of these pagans in these ancient times. And that's what he's doing here in the 12th chapter of Luke. 11th chapter of Luke. We're going to read it again. So cast out demons has to do with the kingdom of God coming into us. And he said, I cast them out with the Spirit of God. He says in the 8th chapter, before I read this, in the 8th chapter of Matthew, I haven't read this in a long time. In the 8th chapter, he says in verse 16 of Matthew, when the evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils. Remember, possessed with devils is a form of daimonion. It's the word daimonizomai. We get our word demon from daimonion. Daimonizomai means to be insane, according to the McClintock and Strong and according to some of my other books. Meant to be crazy. He says they're possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word. Well, he says he cast them out with the Spirit. Here in Matthew 8, he says he cast them out with his word. And the Bible says, thy word is truth. And the Bible says in John 14, 15, 16, John 15, 26, John 16, 13, 1 John 5 and 6, that the Spirit is the truth. Thy word is truth, John 17, 17. So the word of God equals the Spirit of God, equals the truth. And when he writes upon fleshy tables of our hearts, the kingdom of God, we come into the kingdom of God. And in Luke 17, 20 and 21, Jesus says to the Pharisees, the kingdom of God does not come with you seeing it anymore. The kingdom of God is in you. That's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Colossians 1:27. So when he writes upon our hearts, he casts out self. Demons are self. Jesus said, you keep saying they're ghosts, they're spirits, they're gods up in the sky, they're your ancestors come to live inside of you. I can't even begin to tell you all the information that I have on demons. According to the ancient world, what they said they were. They said they called Hercules and Venus and Aphrodite demons. They called Zeus a demon. They called Jupiter a demon. They said it was their ancestors watching over them. They had good demons and bad demons. They had good ghosts and bad ghosts. Ghost was a demon. It was a demon or a god that would live in you and distribute fortunes to you, or it would live in a house you used to own and you died, and the ghost would go back. Some of the ghosts would go through holes in the ground and go down deep in the underworld, and they would live the way they lived on the earth. They had a god among them. They had a manager or a a president among them, one who ruled them. And then some of them that had no place to go that wandered around the earth, and they didn't go into the hole in the ground. This was their beliefs. It would wander around the world as a ghost or a demon that would come and inhabit you. And it had no bones. That's why you couldn't get a hold of it. Couldn't get a hold of it. You couldn't get a hold of a ghost. Had no bones. You couldn't grab one. They said the bones was the strength of the demon. And it would wander around away from the body. I'll tell you the rest of it later. It's just amazing about the bones. Now, look here in Luke. This began to connect with me this week, this past couple weeks. In Luke 12, I begin to see how this is connecting to the bones. If the self is driven out of us, how can I say this? The strength is not in this body or in the bones. Have any of you read in Proverbs how the certain actions of a person was rottenness in the bones? It was rottenness in his strength as a spiritual being. You can look at the bones of bones verses in Proverbs, Psalms, and Proverbs. That's puzzled me. What did it mean, rottenness in the bones? Well, look here. Chapter 11. It has to do with this man wandering in dry places, and they understood that. All right, 11, verse 20. If I with the finger of God cast out devils. So, the word equals the spirit equals the truth, and that was written with the finger of God, finger of God, upon fleshy tables of our heart in 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter. Well, we know that over there in Deuteronomy 9, God wrote upon tables of stone, so this is the law or the truth that's written in our hearts. And the Bible says in Romans, the 5th chapter, that the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. And love there is agape, and we know that in 2 John 6, that agape is walking after the commandments of God, and the commandments of God is the truth, written in our hearts by the Spirit. That's His Word. That's the truth, and that's how demons or self is cast out. Remember we said in Mark, the first chapter, that there was a man with an unclean spirit in the temple, and Jesus walked up to him, and He said, "What have we to do with thee?" And He used plural. And they believed that all most of the demons were feminine gender. And Jesus rebuked him, A-U-T-O. That's our word, A-U-T-O. An automobile is self-mobile. An autobiography is written by the man himself. If you read a biography and it says unauthorized, that means it doesn't have the approval of the man it's about. If it's an autobiography, he wrote it. It's self-biography. So that's an unclean spirit, unclean. So everywhere you find an unclean spirit, it's going to be the same thing as here, right? Well, over here in Luke 4, same man, Luke's account, it's called an unclean demonion. That's mathematical. Things equal to the same thing are equal to each other. The unclean spirit is self, so it's self over here, right? It's self. And when self is, the self is the strong man being cast out. Boy, we are strong. And that goes back to the bones of the body. Our strength, what would I be like if all of a sudden my bones were removed? I'd just squash on the floor, wouldn't I? Have no bones, have no strength. That's what they said the strength of a man's body was. But when self is cast out, the strong man, the strength of a man, which is self, which we want to fulfill with all the things of the world, that's our bone structure. We're cast, self is cast out, and we can't stand for ourselves anymore because we're born into the kingdom of God, which is spiritual, right? Now let's go on down here. If I were the finger of God, cast out devils, the same thing with the Spirit of God, which is the Word of God, which is self, is cast out, then the kingdom has come to us. And that's when we have an interest in the Word of God. Then he says, when a stronger than he is come upon him, when a strong man armed keeps his palace, this is the palace right here. We're the strong man. We're the strength of the structure of the bones within us. When a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him, a stronger than the strong man. Who is that? That's Christ coming into us, driving self out. He taketh from him all his armor, all his protection. What is our protection? It says he spoiled his goods over there in the 12th chapter. What is our goods? That's literal. Cars and our houses and our stands and our stuff and our things and our diamonds and our everything we can possess in this body. What he has to do is take it out of our minds and out of our hearts and replace it with the desire for spiritual things. He has to take all of that out of us. How long does it take him to take self out of us? It takes a lot of fire, trial, persecution. I've said it before, God put me through so much it should have killed a normal man. But he took the desire out of me to live for the flesh. I really long to see Jesus. I want to go be with the Lord. I have a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better than this, but it's more needful for you that I remain. He said, the church needs me until God sees fit to call me away. But I really long to go be with Jesus and get out of all this hassle. But I'm not stressing. I've learned to rest in where I am. And I want to teach you to learn to rest in that, in the spiritual Sabbath. So he says, I'm going to try to say something to you here about bones that it's really overwhelming to me right now. But when a stronger than him comes upon him, that's Christ coming upon us to overcome him. Remember that word overcome. How does he overcome us? N-I-K-A-O is the word overcome. It's the verb form of nike. Overcome is the verb. Nike is the word victory. And what does 1 John the 5th chapter say, the victory that overcomes the world? Even our faith. And faith is death to self, isn't it? Death to self is overcoming by casting out of self, out of us. So when we overcome the world, you overcome the things and the stuff that he possesses. God possesses our cars, our houses, our lands, and it doesn't matter what happens to them. We have to stand up and live in truth in the new man. That's the new man, isn't it? When the stronger than us overcomes us, he says, put on the new man. In duo. When you're baptized into Christ, that's the same thing as overcoming or casting out the demons. It means you've been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. In duo means to sink into clothing. The clothing is the Holy Spirit that's in us by which he casts out self of the demon. Now, then he says, and I'm just beginning to really see the fullness of this, when maybe not completely, but some of it. When a stronger than he comes upon him, and overcomes him, that's Christ overcoming self, he taketh from him all the armor wherein he trusted. What is the armor that we trust in before he overcomes us? What is it? Your car, your job, your house, your things, and you worry about what's going to happen to me if I lose my job, and what's going to happen if we have a collapse in the economy, It's going to happen to everybody, and we'll have one another until Jesus comes and takes us out and divides his spoils. He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Scatter is the verb form of scorpion, which are false teachers. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, it's the same unclean spirit that Jesus calls self over in Mark, the first chapter. He called it a demon in the second chapter of Luke. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, the unclean spirit is self. He walketh through dry places. When God removes the old flesh and you come into spiritual, you come into the spiritual, you begin to walk in dry places. What is it you need when you're dry? You need living water, don't you? If you don't get into the Spirit, which Jesus calls living water, he tells the woman at the well in John 4, I'll give you living water and you'll never thirst again. If you don't grow in the Spirit, if you don't grow in truth, if you don't grow in faith, if your faith doesn't increase, you're like the man in Hebrews 6. If you don't leave the basic principles of the doctrines of faith and go unto perfection, perfection is the word teleos or teleotes. It means maturity. How do you go into maturity? In the Word of God, you go in the Spirit. Thy word is truth, so you have to grow in the Word of God. If you don't leave these basic principles of salvation and go on to maturity and learn the Word of God, you'll end up, he says, apostatizing, and it will be impossible for those who were once enlightened, if they fall away and they apostatize and go off in sin, and God makes them come back, it'll be impossible to renew repentance like it was at the first. You have to live with the shame that you put Christ to an open shame. And that's what he's talking about. You have to go on unto living water and not live in dry places. Seeking rest. You get no rest if you don't grow in faith and grow in truth. You'll sit around worrying about everything all the time, worrying about your car, your house, your job, your things, your stuff. Y'all realize that most of us that are over 60, when you're 55 or above, it's just about over. And everything you got, at 77, I know I'm not going to live much longer. If I live 10 more years, I'll be 87. Then what am I holding on to all this for? When it comes time to die, what you have in the bank is not going to matter. When I had a heart attack, I wasn't saying, Mary, did you lock the door of the house? Did you park the car right? I didn't care about a car. My heart was going. I didn't care whether the house was locked, somebody was stealing, some were getting into my bank account. All I wanted was to breathe. And that's how important things are. I probably don't have more than 10 years to live. You say, you sure are depressing. It's not depressing to me. Maybe to you.
To me.
And to her. She always says, I want to die before you. Money don't mean anything when you get your stuff, your spoils, your goods. The more you grow in faith, the less you care about that. And the more you grow in faith, the more you'll talk to people and tell people truth, and the more they'll crucify you. And then you'll get to, I've said it 1,000 times, if you can get 5 or 6 people to hate you over the truth, one more or less don't matter. You get to a place where I don't care if anybody else don't like me. I got people all over town that call me a cult. I don't care. You're ignorant. That's what you are. Now, let me get on with this, because I wanted to get to this. He He'll walk in dry places. He's talking about the man who's a believer. If you don't grow in truth, if you don't grow in the Spirit, you're going to be in dry places, and you'll go back to your sin. And then God will have to beat you up real good to teach you. He walks in dry places, seeking rest, and finding none, he saith, I'll return to my old self, what I used to be. I will return to my house that I came out of, that I was cast out of. And I'll, you know how I know this is true? I did that. I traveled all over America as a young preacher, not going into real deep teaching. And I went off and I quit gospel singing and I quit preaching. I went into nightclubs. And I sang in probably 250 military base clubs across America. Big fancy officers club at Scott Air Force Base in Belleville, Illinois, and Offutt Air Force Base in Omaha, Nebraska, and Maxwell down in Texas, and Luke and Davis-Monthan out in Arizona. And I've been in Kissaria up in Michigan, and I've been in Pope Air Force Base over in North Carolina, Fort Bragg, Fort Pope, Fort Sill, Fort this, Fort that, hundreds of them. And I went off and fell into the depths of sin, and I put Christ to an open shame. And I preached to some people sitting at tables. They'd say, you sound like a preacher. I'd say, I am. I got to do my next set. Excuse me, please. And I knew the truth when I was sitting in those clubs with somebody at the table. And when he cometh, he finds it's all swept and garnished. Hey, I'm coming back to my sin, but I see my house is clean. I've been living a clean life, but I haven't been growing. Then goeth he and taketh unto him seven other spirits more wicked than himself. I believe God is saying, you're getting perfect. Seven is the number of divine perfection. He says, now you're going to go back and get perfect in your sin. Perfected in your sin. Remember, they called demons, daemonion, they called their sins by the title of demons in the first century. More wicked than himself, they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of the man is worse than the first. He says, you get off in sin, and that's worse than you were before, because you know better. Now, let me read something to you. I was reading out of, and this brought me to this, being dry and roaming around the world. I was reading out of my McClintock and Strong. There's a section, not McClintock and Strong, Hastings Encyclopedia of Religion and Ethics. This is Hastings Encyclopedias. And you look up in it, demons and spirits. It's these Hastings. And I'll just start reading. You don't know what you're going to run into. And I ran into the bones thing. I've been wondering what this was about all through the Scripture for years. And this is demons and spirits, the Assyrians and the Babylonians, demons and spirits, Buddhist, demons and spirits, Celtic. It'll take into Japanese demons and spirits, Chinese demons and spirits, Egyptian demons and spirits. It'll have a section on each one of them, and it'll tell you what they believed about them. In the introduction, it says, demon means to apportion, which means to divide and distribute. And we said that it means to distribute fortunes, and the love of money is the root of all evil. But fortunes is more than just money and things. Fortunes is glory, it's applause, it's attention. Everybody wants to be special and get a lot of attention, don't we? Huh? Isn't that what we wanted in life, by writing songs, by getting on the stage and performing, by doing better than somebody else and buying another motorcycle and wanting all these stuff and things and whatever you wanted, to get up in a company and buy the things you want? Isn't that what life is about to the man who's got the strong man in him? You know what it's about? I was just reading along here. Of course, it's got all about Jinn and genies and Lilith, the first wife of Adam. And Lilith was the queen of the demons and the queen of the genies. It was first supposed to be the second wife of Adam, excuse me. Eve was the first wife. Lilith was the second wife, because Lilith was what Eve became when she started distributing fortunes. Demon means to distribute fortunes. And all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is what Eve saw on the tree. Tree to be desired. It was good for food. Fulfill the lust of the flesh. It was pleasant to the eye. The lust of the eye, John said. And it would make her wise. She could be proud. That's what John said. Was everything in the world distributing fortunes. And how many wishes do you get from a genie?
Three.
And everything that's in the world is encompassed among those three items. You can go into the witches. They said there's three things you can get among witchcraft. Look at the word three every time you see it. And look here. And I don't believe threes, sevens and fours go together. Elevens and twos go together. We've gone through messages on that. I believe God has ordained everything in a, it synthesizes. But listen to this. This is under Assyrians, Babylonians. And I'll read some of this to you. I don't know if I can fully explain it like I want to. Huh. But listen, this is under Assyrian demons and spirits. Another incantation, although it confuses ghosts with demons, and I believe they're the same, refers to the return of the hostile spirits. This is talking about the spirit that's hostile and he goes back to the body. Like Jesus was using their terminology. They would recognize it. The evil spirit, the evil demon, the evil ghost, the evil devil from the earth have come forth from the pure abode into the earth. They have come forth. In heaven they are unknown. On earth they are not understood. In the instance of Utuku, Wraith, or Eibani being raised like Samuel at Endor, the text continues with the speech of the ghost describing the underworld to Gilgamesh, who was another name, it's believed, for Nimrod. The man whose corpse lieth in the desert, a place of dry places. I don't think I'm going to get through all this. Thou and I have often seen such in one. His spirit resteth not in the earth. Remember, Jesus said when the strong man is cast out, he goes into dry places and he goes into the earth. And reading my other books, they talk about the spirit being released from the body. That was a demon that could go possess something. That's imagination. That it was cast out into the street or his food. They say in among the mythology of all races that ghosts live on food and they're not immortal. They have to keep being fed. Sacrifices. You have to sacrifice to these kind of demons. But ghosts were like temporarily on the earth and sometimes they were in under the earth. Then he says, besides the unfed ghosts, however, there was also the spirit of the unburied body to haunt mankind. The body had to be buried and had to be buried with the bones. According to Syrian ideas, which tally in great measure with those modern savages, if the bones of the dead were removed from the tomb, according to these people, the spirit at once became restless. Sounds like that the spirit that walks in dry places, the strong man that walks in dry places, and was compelled to roam about the world. Those are what they call demons that could come and possess somebody. Do you believe that? No. Ashurbanipal, this hit me right here. He was one of the Syrian kings who came against Israel. Ashurbanipal, giving full credence of this belief in his invasion of Elam, carries away the bones of the kings of Elam from the tombs and causes the rites paid to them to cease, that their spirits may have no rest. The bones were carried away that they didn't have any rest. They said that the bones had to be buried in the home of the people, the homeland of the people, where they came from. It looks like Israel practiced that. I don't know whether it was superstition. Perhaps that's what Joseph had been influenced with in Egypt. He told Israel, take my bones out of Egypt when you go. That has preyed on my mind for years. To cease, that their spirits may have no rest. I began to see this identifies what Jesus said. If I cast out the strong man with the finger of God, and he goes out into dry places. They understood that in the first century when he said that. He said, you can't go into dry places. You cannot go where there's no living water when you become a believer, because you'll go back into sin and put Christ to an open shame. You have to grow. If you don't grow, you will end up back in sin as a believer. And God says, I'll have to beat you to get you out of here. You're mine. You're not going to live the way you want. You're not your own. You're bought with a price. Now let me read this. They have no rest. Furthermore, unless the body was buried, the spirit of the dead man was never reached a resting place. It says there in Luke 21, he had no rest. He was in dry places. And he went back to the house, back to this body, and he gets back into sin. And they understood that. We don't, do we? They knew that. Let me read to you something about bones. This puzzled me for years. They were practicing something that those people believed. Look at Genesis 50. Go to Genesis 50. They said burial was an honorable thing. You couldn't leave a man unburied, otherwise his spirit would get out there in the world and want to inhabit somebody as a demon, as a ghost. Ghosts were demons. Demons were gods. Trying to overcome all, what has happened? People begin to pollute the Word of God. Now nothing will be restrained from them, which they've imagined to do when they said, let us make us a name. Let us make up our own doctrine. He said, now you'll get involved in your imagination. You'll think there's demons. You'll think there's ghosts. They go into the underworld. You'll think that man has to have his body buried where his bones are. Don't do away with his bones. They said Ashurbanipal carried the bones of the kings away from Elam. Why? They said without the bones, his spirit would wander around and he'd never have rest. That's what Jesus was talking about in Luke 11. He was saying something to them that they understood. If he cast out self by the word of God, and you don't grow in truth, your spirit will wander around the world, and you'll be the demon, and you put Christ to an open shame. Let me read this here. Genesis. I've seen this all through the Bible, and I couldn't figure it out until I hit this extra-biblical material on demons in Assyria and Babylon. Now look here in as to what Joseph was thinking, remember, he was in Egypt. The Egyptians had all these superstitions about bones and about wandering around. So he says, my bones have to be buried over there in Israel. In verse 24, and Joseph said unto his brethren, I die. And God will surely visit you and bring you out of the land into the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath of the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones from here. I wondered, what was that for years? He was either influenced by Egyptian thought. Remember, he had a divining cup that he accused his little brother Benjamin of taking, trying to trick him, but he had the point is he had the divining cup. Joseph was influenced by a lot of the Egyptian thought. He was a spiritual man, but he had a worldly life that he was thinking a lot of the things that they were thinking because they were talking about it all the time. These guys were humans. Joseph doesn't show he had any sin, but he did have. He was the picture of Christ. And Joseph died being 110 years old, and they embalmed him. He was put in a coffin in Egypt. He said, but when this deliverer comes, it'll be Moses 400 years from now. Take my bones back home and bury them there. Back in this day and time, they didn't have a funeral immediately. They would take a man, put him in a sepulcher, and they would wait until his body deteriorated and there was nothing left but bones, and they would have a eulogy service over the bones. They said the bones was the strength and the structure of a man. It was his strength. Look over here in Exodus 13. Exodus 13, you just had the last Passover. This is 400 years later. Exodus 13 and 19. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him. Why would God repeat this? This has gotten me to thinking. And I knew all these verses were here. I didn't know what the bones were for. That was the strength. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he had straitly sworn the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry my bones away hence with you. A lot of superstition going on here. And look over here in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Why would God repeat it? It has something to do for our edification. All the scripture has to do with edifying us. Look at Hebrews 11. And I'm still working on this, I'll be honest with you. Still working on it. But I can see what Jesus was saying. It has to do with driving the strong man out of Israel. It has to do with the scapegoat that was driven out of Israel in the 16th chapter of Leviticus. Because Jesus said, this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. In the 17th chapter of Matthew, kind is the word genos. It means kinfolk. Jesus used their terminology to identify with them. And the only fast in Israel, the only legitimate fast that was authorized by God, was over in the Day of Atonement, where they would fast and afflict their soul. Afflict the soul meant to humble self. It was the word oni, ona. It meant to afflict self. It meant to humble self. And the fast in Israel is described in the 58th chapter of Isaiah. It's the leveling of self. It's humbling self. But just because you humble self at the beginning, you've got to go on unto perfection. Otherwise, you'll put Christ in open shame. If you don't grow in the truth, you can't stay a baby. God says, I'm not going to let you stay babes. You have to grow. He said, you were babes when you started. God has revealed this unto babes. Even so, it seemed good in thy sight there in Luke, the 10th chapter. And we're the babes that he's revealed it to, but he does not want us to stay babies. He wants us to grow in truth. If you don't, you'll go back to sin, put Christ in open shame, and you're in for the beating of your life. I know, because I've gone through that. And he says here, where was I going? Hebrews 11. I would look at these, I'd see these bones, I couldn't figure it out. What were they doing? It was their strength. So they said it had to be buried in their homeland. Hebrews 11, verse 22. By faith, Joseph, when he died, made mention of the departing of the children of Israel and giving commandment concerning his bones. Now look back over here let's look at the bones of the man of God. And I saw this, and I've thought about this for years. I couldn't figure it out. It's one of those things I didn't even discuss with my wife, Mary. I've just been thinking about it a long time. I think about a lot of things I don't conclude. Look at 1 Kings 13. There's a man of God. When Jeroboam, the king of northern Israel, how much time do I have, Mike? 19. I ain't going to have time to get through this. When Jeroboam, the king of northern Israel, when Rehoboam took some advice from his high school teenage buddies, say, my father chastised you with whips, I'll chastise you with scorpions. The 10 northern tribes split because of Solomon's apostasy, letting his wives going after all these other gods, and they split in order for Jeroboam to keep from going back south, he keep the people, the 10 northern tribes, from going back and joining Rehoboam. Rehoboam didn't attack Jeroboam because the prophet Shimei come to him and said, don't attack, told Rehoboam, don't attack northern Israel, this is of God. Well, Jeroboam organized golden calf worship up there to keep Israel from going back and said, this is the gods that brought you out of Egypt. And when he did that, he brought golden calf into northern Israel, and a man that's called the man of God came and prophesied against northern Israel for Jeroboam bringing golden calf, and that kept the nation split. The golden calf was more or less title deed to the kingdom of Israel. So he kept him from going back south. And the man of God comes and prophesies against the altars of northern Israel. And all the Levites, which are the priests of God, say, we can't handle this golden calf worship. And they headed south and went into southern Judah. But, of course, it bleeds on down into southern Judah later. The man of God, I'll just read a little bit about him here, in the 12th chapter, in the 13th chapter of 1 Kings, 13th chapter. And I'm just going to see the man of God. And behold, there came a man of God, verse 1, out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel. And Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense. And he cried against the altar in the word of the Lord and said, O altar, thus saith the Lord, behold, a child shall be born unto the house of David, Josiah. This is 334 years before Josiah is born, or before he reigns, and he's prophesied by name. You reckon the sovereignty of God is involved in this? 334 years before you get to that 23rd chapter, and he has the greatest revival in Israel, where he kills all the priests of Baal. By name, and upon thee shall he offer the priests of the high places that burn incense upon thee, and the men's bones shall be burnt upon thee. That's significant, but I don't have time to go into it. Then he talks about the man of God in verse 7, talks about the man of God in verse, I've got him all over here. About the man of God in verse 14, how the man of God dies, he's killed by a lion. I don't have time to go in this chapter. I'm going to run out of time if I don't just hop through here. Then he talks about him being killed later in the chapter. But look over here in 2 Kings 23 when Josiah is the king of Israel and he has this great revival. And the man of God is buried here and he's never given a name. Just called the man of God. He's one of God's prophets that didn't have a name. In the 23rd chapter of 2 Kings, Josiah has this great revival. Hilkiah the high priest finds the book of the law, gives the book of the law to Shaphan. Shaphan takes it to Josiah, who's king. And Josiah's father was Ammon. He was an evil man. His grandfather was Manasseh. He was an evil man. And his great-grandfather was Hezekiah, a righteous man. And the word of God had become obsolete through Manasseh and Ammon. And when Josiah reads the book of the law, he begins to weep. He says, we're cleaning out the land of all Baal and grove worship. The greatest revival that ever took place is in the 23rd chapter of 2 Kings. No man ever lived that walked after the law of God like Josiah. And he says that in the 23rd chapter, and after Josiah has his great revival, look here at verse 17 of 23. Then he said, what title is that I see? Well, let me read 16. And Josiah turned himself. He spied the sepulchres that were there in the mount and sent and took the bones out of the sepulchres and burned them upon the altar. And that was one of the greatest insults you could do. And polluted it according to the word of God, word of the Lord, which the man of God proclaimed. This is the fulfillment of the man of God over there in the 13th chapter, 1 Kings. He said there'd be a man named Josiah come along and do this 334 years before he came along. who proclaimed these words. Then he said, "What title is that I see?" And the men of the city told him, "He is the sepulcher of the man of God, which came from Judah and proclaimed those things that thou hast done against the altar of Bethel." And he said, "Let him alone. Let no man move his bones." I never understood that. They believed moving the bones out away like Ashurbanipal did of the kings of Edom, their spirit would wander around and they would become demons and possess somebody. And look here in, go to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. I've thought of this all along. I didn't know what to do with it until I got to reading about demons and spirits in Assyrian Babylonian in the Hastings. And here in 1 Samuel 31, Saul is going to fight his last battle, and he's going to die in this battle. And when he dies, he fell upon a sword. There's so much to this, I can't get into all of it. He fell upon his own sword. He saw that the Philistines were going to take him, and he knew that they would torture him in their overcoming Saul. This was God's will that Saul die. The night before, he had talked to the witch of Endor, saying, "Conjure up Samuel for me." Well, she couldn't do that, but God conjured up Samuel, and she went, "I can't do that," and she takes off. Samuel has been dead for 2 years, and he says, "Saul, tomorrow you and your sons are going to die, and you're going to be with me." Saul died and went to be with the Lord. He was the anointed of the Lord, even though he did a lot of wicked things. He kind of went into a place of dry places. He didn't grow. And here in 31, 1 Samuel, Saul dies, and when the inhabitants, verse 11, when the inhabitants of Jabesh Gilead heard of that which the Philistines had done to Saul, all the valiant men arose and went all night and took the body of Saul and the bodies of his sons from the wall of Beth Shean and came to Jabesh and burnt them there. And they took their bones and buried them under a tree at Jabesh and fasted 7 days. Took his bones. Why does he keep saying this? The bones was the strength of a man. They believed, perhaps Saul believed. I wouldn't say that Saul and Joseph were perfect people. Perhaps they had taken on some of the culture of the land. Maybe they believed that their bones had to be buried. If the bones weren't buried and it was laying out in the open, they said the spirit would wander around, become detached from the body. Animism is what they call that. So they took Saul's bones and buried them at Jabesh. But that's not Saul's home. And these are superstitious people. The reason they did it was Saul's first battle was in the 11th chapter of 1 Samuel. The men of Jabesh Gilead had been attacked. They were attacked by the king of the Ammonites. And the king of the Ammonites came down and said, "We want your unconditional surrender, and we want every man in your army to have his right eye punched out." Why the right eye? Most people are right-handed. And that was the bow eye. So, "Want your eyes punched out." They said, "Give us 7 days, and if we can't find anybody to rescue us, we'll surrender to you and do that." And Saul heard about it, the king of Israel, and he went into a rage, and he went out and rescued the people of Jabesh. That's why they took his bones here. He was their hero. He was their rescuer. Of all the bad things that he did, that's one of the good things. So they took him, and look over here, and well, I can't go to 1 Samuel 11, it'd take me too much time, but look at 2 Samuel 21. And I kept seeing these bones. They placed a lot of stock in that. But remember, the man that walks in dry places, to them, it was a man that wasn't buried correctly. I've gone into bones. I've got so much on this. I've got whole sections of bones. The Jews had a word for it. Likut, Azumat, means the gathering of the bones. Remember Ezekiel, the 37th chapter? God's going to gather the bones of Israel. Ezekiel looks down into the valley and he sees the valley of dry bones, and they're very dry. Very dry means they've been in the sun a long time. It's talking about the time period of Israel being in captivity for 2,600 years. And God says, I'm going to speak to... He said, Ezekiel, you speak to those bones. And he said, they'll come together, bone to his bone, the head bone connected to the neck bone connected to the shoulder bone connected to the backbone connected to the hip bone connected to the knee bone. Now hear the word of the Lord. That's where that comes from. He said, you speak to the bones, and I will bring life into the bones. That's preaching to the dead elect, and God will bring life to the dead elect. This is a very important thing to him, to have the bones buried where they're supposed to be buried. And you can read that story. Saul's first battle was in the 11th chapter of 1 Samuel when he attacked Nahash, the king of the Ammonites. And he rescued the men of Jabesh Gilead. And look here in 2 Samuel 21. 2 Samuel 21, verse 12. And David went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan. You think this has any meaning at all when you see these kinds of things? That's been going through my mind for years. Why take these bones back? They may have been practicing superstition, not really believing it. Maybe it was a custom among the Jews. But they were doing this because it was the wrong place to bury their people. They needed to be in Israel. And David went and took the bones, or the strength of Saul, and the bones of Jonathan his son, from the men of Jabesh Gilead, which had stolen them from the street of Bethshean, where the Philistines had hanged them when the Philistines had slain Saul at Gilboa in the 31st chapter of 1 Samuel. I wondered about this for a long time, and I was still working on it. Look at 1 Chronicles 10.
You can keep reading.
Well, all right. Do I need to?
Yeah.
Okay, 2 Samuel. Hold on, I flipped away. 2 Samuel 21:12. All right. I just try to get to everything and I can't. And he brought up thence the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan his son, and they gathered the bones of them that were hanged. The bones of Saul and Jonathan his son buried they in the country of Benjamin. That's where Saul was from. It had to be home. He was a Benjamite. They believed that you had to have the bones at home. You couldn't bury them in an open field, otherwise the spirit would go out and walk in dry places. When Jesus said that, when the strong man is cast out, he needs to go where there's food. They said those spirits had to be fed among the pagans. You have a spiritual food is the Holy Spirit. I know this seems to be a lot of information. I don't know how to teach this. I'll come back and say some more on it. In Zelah, in the sepulcher of Kish, his father. They wanted to be buried with their fathers in the same sepulcher. And they performed all that the king commanded after that God was entreated for the land. And look at 1 Chronicles 10. And when you see these things, if you study on it, you find something else on it, you tell me. When you go into the bones, when the Bible will talk about, I got so much more on this, rottenness in the bone in Proverbs 12 and 40, rottenness in the bone, it meant rottenness in the strength of a man. In Proverbs 14 and 30, a good report maketh the bone fat. Over there in Proverbs 15 and 30, it's talking about the spiritual strength of a man. Or making the bones fat in Proverbs 16:24, and a broken spirit drieth the bone in Proverbs 17:22. It makes a man weak. Drieth the bone. In other words, without any spiritual strength. gosh, you've got all these things on the bone in the new, in the Old Testament. Look at 1 Chronicles 10. The whole point of this is your bones has to be strengthened. Don't I take bone strength, calcium, to be strong physically? We have a spiritual strength. It's spiritual bones, spiritual strength. But not if you don't grow in the Spirit, if you don't grow in faith. Besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith. If you add to your faith these seven things, you'll never fall. Notice how these things come together very slow in your mind. I'm not trying to give you a totally full picture on this because I don't think I've got a full picture. I looked at bones in the Hastings. Got a couple of pages just on bones. At one place, a man fell in a sepulcher where Elisha was buried. He touched Elisha and he came alive. I do not know what that's about.
If I may interrupt, because it's important, Hastings is totally free on the internet. It's there.
Okay. Well, okay. You can announce that after church if you want to. I've got so much on bones here. Here's on shades. This is out of Mythology of All Races. They talk about the ancestral spirits are called Chaga and defined as shadows of people who have died. The shadow is often identified with life or soul or one of the souls. The ghosts are so-called, say the Wakaga, because they have no bones. They look like living people, only you cannot take hold of them, and when you see them, they're apt to vanish suddenly and instantaneously. That's all imagination. They make movies about that. They got a commercial about a movie, and the girl's looking down the hallway and sees these two spirits and then turns around, they're not there. It's not true. It's imagination. It's let us make us a name. They've imagined all this about bones and about... They have a lot to say about burning bones. And it would seem as if everyone remained at the age he or she reached death when they die. Why would we all die and little kids say little kids in heaven? They live underground much as they had done on earth. And they have their chiefs and their tribal assemblies. And when a man dies, he passes the dwelling place of his own clan. Clan means family. And that was their ancestors. Demons in Pentecostal churches, that's imagination. It's not true. Don't believe that stuff. We live in a land of reality. The evil in a man is his heart. That's evil. It's self. And you got to come out of self, and you got to grow in the Spirit. And if you don't, you're going to go off into sin. You're going to return to the house that's been cleansed, swept and garnished. You're going to come back into self and say, I'm going to go live the way I want to as a believer like I did. And I have to live with some shame in my life as a believer. You cannot be renewed to repentance like you were back here. You can repent. But it cannot be brand new repentance like it was over here. I've run out of time and I haven't finished this at all. I just challenge you to look into the bones thing. Look at, if you got history books, if you got culture books on Israel, you might find one thing in it that I can't find. Just keep it in mind. Let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. Thank you for your word. I really believe that everything you've put in the Scripture is for our benefit, including this on the burial of bones. Lord, help us to see your truth. Fight our battles for us. Cause us to continue to grow so we're not dried up in dry places. We'll praise you for all things. Lead us to your elect. Open up doors for the ministry. We'll keep preaching these truths in Christ's name. Amen. I just barely got started on that.
Jim didn't mean to interrupt.
Huh?
I know how hard it was to get those books.
What?
I didn't mean to interrupt, but I know how hard it is to get Hastings.
Well, you can buy these. I'm a book person. I won't sit and read the internet for hours, but I'll sit and read these for hours.
Are they still for sale?
Huh?
Hastings still for sale? I didn't.
You can find some on the internet. You can find them on Amazon. If you look enough, you can find a set of.
Oh, okay.
Probably be about $300, maybe four, but they're worth every penny of it. So is a McClintock and Strong.
For those who can't afford it.
For the people that can't afford it, they can.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you can't afford it, you can get it on the internet.
Yeah.
I just like books. I'm a book person.
It's phenomenal.
Yeah, it really is. If you find anything on bones,
just go to Google and say Hastings Bible.
Find anything on bones, let me know.
Whatever the name of it is up there, but Hastings God Bible.
It goes further than the Bible. The Bible comes.
You're able to get anything free.
It may have something in.
As far as Hastings,
just look up in the index section if they got some on bones.
Well, it's more about the burials.
So we go.
About what?
Burials.
Yeah, I've been looking at burial too. Hey, what are you doing up there?
How are you, man?
I'm doing pretty good. Let me give you something here.
Thank you.
You put Hastings?
That was great today.
Bible.
That's a lot of stuff.
What's interesting? Interesting information.
How many do you put?
Well, it is. It's just that people are not interested in that.
How many places do you hear about that?
Nowhere. And to see that man is driven into dry places, I got to come back to that because that's the scapegoat.
Yeah, it's so devastating just to look across the street and look at these churches. You know,
how many
1,500 cars out there, you know there ain't 2 ounces of information.
They're not. They're not any information.
And the 2 ounces is diluted on top of that.
It is. You can find this stuff if you research, but it takes a lot of research. I'll just start reading them.
But 15 years ago, he was saying Hastings. So I go out there, I'm okay.
He's no matter where.
And that was all in this one and a couple other books.
You find the parallels, you know.
And you know, that was true, of course.
Yeah.
That's why you go back to the PDF research. You get caught up in the PDF.
This is when I hit something I've been wondering about for years, and I've been wondering about it. And I hit that. If God wants us to understand that, their superstition was if you don't row, you can't If you die and leave you out of the world, you're left in the old world without any protection of God, without my Savior.
It's going to come by.
It's going to be the same thing. You wander around as a spirit.
Sometimes it's nice just to listen.
Everything was.
It's just another word for perfection in Hebrews 6. If you don't grow, you're not going to stay out of sin. What it's saying, if you don't grow in the truth, you're going to go back to sin.
Alice Cooper had a bag. It was cardboard. I didn't mean to interrupt, but when I found it this week, I just lost it.
I can't get over how stupid we are in America. How stupid they think. They think if they read something in English, that's what they meant 2,000 years ago in Greek.
Beautiful wife in Jacksonville, working on her master's thesis. And she will not bring it to
me. You can get fixed.
She did last week. And she says, especially when a truck comes up.
Well, you know.
I want to teach about this.